Welcome to our Servant School class on prayer. This week, our lesson is titled, What Hinders Prayer? I wonder sometimes if we don't get occasionally just a little superstitious when it comes to prayer. A rabbi is walking slowly down the street when a gust of wind blows his hat from his head. The hat is being blown down the street, and he's an old man, and he can't walk fast enough to catch the hat. Across the street, a Gentile looks and sees what's happened, and he rushes over to grab the hat and return it to the rabbi. I don't think I would have been able to catch my hat, said the rabbi. Well, thank you very much. The rabbi then places his hand on the man's shoulder and says, May God bless you. The young man thinks to himself, I've been blessed by the rabbi. This must be my lucky day. So he goes to the racetrack, and in the first race, he sees that there's a horse named Stetson at 20-1. He bets $50, and sure enough, the horse comes in first. The second race, he sees a horse named Fedora at 30-1. So he bets it all, and the horse comes in first also. Finally, at the end of the day, he returns home to his wife. When she asks him where he's been, he explains how he caught the rabbi's hat and was blessed by him, and then went to the track and started winning on horses that had a hat in their names. Well, so where's the money, she asks. Oh, I lost it all in the ninth race. I bet on a horse named Chateau, and it lost. You fool! Chateau is a house. Chapeau is a hat. Well, it doesn't matter, he says. The winner was some Japanese horse named Yamaka. I'm not sure that God really works that way. I don't think that prayer is some kind of a magical, mysterious thing. So let's talk about what hinders prayer. I've got four things to share. Number one is, what hinders prayer? Well, we just don't do it. We've seen in James 4:2, James writes, you do not have because you do not ask. Well, so what are some of the reasons why we don't pray? Maybe it's because we feel like we're too busy. We might not be allowing ourselves enough time in our schedule to set aside for prayer. Maybe we haven't yet developed the habit. We don't have a regular time set aside to prayer, and then we forget to pray. Some of us don't think that we're worthy to pray. So we don't. Yet to be honest, by ourselves, none of us are worthy. We are only worthy because of Jesus and his sacrifice for us. Jesus is our great high priest, and he has made it possible for us to pray, to talk to God. Hebrews 4:14-16 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Well, back to why don't we pray? Well, maybe we're not really sure that prayer works. We've prayed for things before, and they didn't turn out the way that we wanted them to. I'd like to challenge you to rethink some of those thoughts. Perhaps there's lessons about prayer you need to learn. Prayer is not about getting our way with God. It's about getting God's way for us. Let me say that again. Prayer is not about getting our way with God. It's about getting God's way for us. I've often heard some folks say that they don't think that the thing that they're wanting is worth taking up God's time, so they'll just handle it themselves. You know, they don't want to bother God with their problems. I got news for you. That's not true. God sent his Son to die for you. He definitely thinks that you must be worth it. In the end, there's really no good reason for us not to pray. Now, what else hinders prayer? Let's say number two is sin. Psalm 66:18 says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. The ESV translation reads it like this. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. If I held it in my heart and I just, Oh, I just like that idea, man. I just like that. Well, says the Lord will not listen. Sin is a way of cutting off our communication with God. It's kind of like cutting the cord on a landline telephone. It's like your microwave cutting off the Wi-Fi in your house. Did you know that? When I do not deal with sin in my heart, my prayers are hindered. Now, James 4:3 says, you ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Here's another way that sin hinders prayer. My sinful nature can influence me to be asking for the wrong things. It may be that my prayers are more about what makes me comfortable than they are about what makes me more useful. It may be that my prayers have ulterior motives. I pray for that pretty young girl so that I can get closer to her, and you know what I'm saying. Now, the problem with sin is this. We are all sinners. Romans 3:23 says we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So how can God ever hear our prayers? Well, it's easy, my friends. We need to learn to admit our sin to God. We need to turn from our sin, and we need to receive the cleansing that God desires for us. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's not a bad thing to start your prayer time every day with words kind of like what David prayed in Psalm 139. This is the last two verses of Psalm 139. He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. If God makes me aware of an area that's wrong in my life, then I confess it to God, and then I pray. So what else hinders prayer? Number three, I'm going to say, is God's will. Now, you may be wondering, how can God's will be hindering us from praying? Let me explain. 1 John 5, verses 14 and 15 says this. Now, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. And so this is a key verse when it comes to praying. The key to answered prayer is learning to ask for the things that God wants to do. The word that's translated will, the Greek word is thelema. It means what one wishes. It means will, choice, inclination, desire, or pleasure. We want to be asking for things that God has a desire to do. Things that please God. Now, how do I know if something is God's will? Well, let me ask this. Is it clear in God's word? There are a few things that are clearly in God's word. Paul was encouraging Timothy to pray when he drops this truth about God's will. 1 Timothy 2:4 says that God desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, the word that translates desires is the verb form of thelema. This is what God desires. This is what God wants. This is what pleases God. So should we be praying for specific people to be saved? It is God's will. It's God's desire. Now, will they get saved? Well, see, that's where it gets a little complicated. I think this is one area where mankind's free will can be in conflict with God's desires, but we can still pray. Now, how else do I know if something is God's will? Well, secondly, we learn God's will through prayer. I find that sometimes I'm praying for something for years before I have a clear indication of whether this is God's will or not. And on those kinds of issues, you don't find out until you pray and keep praying. There are some things that I have prayed for, and after months or even years, I feel a growing conviction that God wants me to stop praying for it. This happened several times with Jeremiah. In Jeremiah 7:16, God says, therefore, do not pray for this people, nor lift up a cry for them, nor make intercession to me, for I will not hear you. Now, this doesn't happen all the time, but this can be a part of the work of prayer, is that sometimes this is how we sort out what we should be praying for. Is it if God's kind of nudges you and says, no, you're asking for the wrong thing, well, maybe it's time to stop. Maybe it's not God's will. Now, the fourth thing, what hinders prayer, I'm going to call it God's timing. Timing and prayer is a little like destroying a Death Star.
Have you not?
Now, destroying a Death Star requires a lot of things, but you aren't going to be able to destroy the Death Star unless the timing is perfect. What do I mean by this? We need to be okay with knowing that God has perfect timing. God has perfect timing. After Jerusalem fell to the Babylonians in 586 BC, the prophet Jeremiah found himself traveling with a small group of Jews who had survived the fall. There had been a political assassination. The Babylonian-appointed governor had been killed. The people were concerned that Babylon was going to come back and wipe the rest of them out. And so they asked Jeremiah to seek God and to find out what they were supposed to do. Jeremiah 42:7, neat little nugget here. It says, "And it happened after 10 days that the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah." So it took 10 days before the great prophet Jeremiah heard the answer from God. We aren't told why it took so long. It just did. Did all of his prayers get answered after 10 days? No, some of them were instantly. But they had to learn to wait for it. To wait for it. 8 days after Jesus' birth, his parents took him to Jerusalem to be circumcised. It was there that they met a fellow named Simeon, an older fellow. Luke chapter 2, verse 25, it says, "And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, 'Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the faces of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.'" This man had been praying for Jesus, the Savior, the Messiah, to come for years. Why didn't he see this earlier than this? Why did he have to wait so long? It just wasn't time. It wasn't time. When we start to pray for specific requests, we're going to find that God tends to answer in, I'm going to say, one of three ways. Sometimes it's yes, sometimes it's no, and sometimes it's not yet, not yet. Sometimes the thing we are praying for is the right thing. It's just not time. Will you keep praying for it? I hope so. I hope so. And I hope that helps.